Thursday, there were only two slides on College Rama, but we already discussed, probably the whole recording is still on the machine, so they will put it on College Rama. And the recovery rate is 99%, so probably it's okay. Last week we were talking about sand cutting. Hoor jij de... Okay. So we discussed dilatancy. Before cutting, probably you have a dense sand. Then during the shearing you get dilatation and the porosity is increasing. Because of the increasing of the porosity, water has to flow to the shear zone. And water will only flow if you have a pressure difference. Since the outside pressure, which we generally call the hydrostatic pressure, will not change, the only thing that can change is the pressure between the particles, so the pore pressure. And that's what happens. This pore pressure had a limitation, and this limitation is when the under pressure in the pores reaches the water vapor pressure, because at that moment water starts to cook and the pressure cannot decrease anymore. Since for normal temperatures, let's say 10 degrees, this water vapor pressure is just 0.01 bar, which is 1% of a bar, we consider it zero. So in normal calculations, we consider that the limit is the absolute zero pressure. Yeah, not 0.01, but absolute zero, because the difference is just 1%. In general, with soil cutting, or with everything that has to do with soil mechanics, you should consider that the accuracy of the soil mechanical parameters is not too high. So if you talk about an angle of internal friction, maybe in a laboratory you can determine it within 1 degree, but if you look at samples from real life, in situ samples as we call them, yeah, maybe it's 2 or 3 degrees. The permeability, which is of great influence to this process, yeah, it can vary between 10-3 to 10-5, which is a factor 100. And then you can imagine if it's easy to make an error with a factor 2. Well, if you make an error with a factor 2, the forces are 2 times too high or 2 times too low. So those accuracies are not really too high. That means that if we neglect the 1% of the water vapor pressure, that's an accuracy of 1%, and it's really neglectable compared with the accuracy that you have in the soil mechanical parameters. So that's why we say, okay, we neglect it. It makes all the equations a little bit more simple. Okay, what did we have? We wanted to calculate the pore pressures, and this shows that in this area you have a certain flow from two sides, from the top and from the bottom. Water has to flow to that area because that's where you are increasing the porosity. This shows again how the water can flow from 4 directions, but in reality at one point of the shear plane the water can only come from 2 directions, not from 4 directions. Later I will show you a method where actually I let the water flow from 4 directions. The method works well, but is scientifically incorrect. But that happens more in science, that you have a calculation method that gives good results, but it doesn't mean it's always scientifically 100%. But I will show you later. We needed a mesh. This was the coarse mesh. This was the fine mesh. The finer the mesh, the more accurate the calculations, but also the longer the calculation time for the computer. And nowadays that's not really a problem, although I think if every time you have to wait 1 hour behind your laptop before a calculation is finished, and if there's a possibility to do it in 5 minutes, you would prefer the 5 minutes because you do much more calculations in 1 day. In those days, it was a matter of money, and so if we could make the mesh coarser, it was cheaper. But still, your calculations have to be accurate enough. Well, this was the result, equipotential lines, where the biggest under pressure is in this area close to the edge of the blade and on the shear plane. This gives the same picture but then in color, and I found this picture which gives the flow lines. So here you can see that in this whole area there is hardly anything flowing, but in this area, so this is like a flow line. Yeah, the division between two colors is a flow line. Here you have flow lines and equipotential lines together. Now we have a number of issues in the equations that we were using. We solved the forces, the horizontal, the vertical force, yeah, we can calculate them. But there was still one unknown in those equations, and that one unknown was the shear angle, the angle of the shear plane. So, in fact, equivalent to the derivations that I have already shown you of active and passive soil failure, where the beta was also the unknown and we had to solve the beta analytically. In this case, we also have to find the beta, but the equations are so complicated that you cannot do it analytically. One reason is the equations are complicated. The second reason is, in the equations, you have to use those pore pressures, and those pore pressures are the result of the finite element calculations, which is not a nice continuous equation, but which is a table of numbers that are the result of those finite element calculations. So basically, it's impossible to analytically solve which beta would result in the smallest force. So what do we do for each case? We do a number of calculations and draw the forces as a function of this shear angle. So here you see the shear angle ranging from 15 degrees to 45 degrees. This is just for the example. Here you see alpha is 60 degrees, so that's a 60 degree blade. And then I calculated the horizontal force, which is the lower line, and the total force, just to see if it would make a big difference. But if you use the principle of minimum energy, you only need the horizontal force. Because energy, you can derive it from power. Well, power is force times velocity, but the force has to be in the direction of the velocity. Yeah, if it's perpendicular, it doesn't contribute to the power. Since we talk about a horizontal cutting velocity, that means we need the horizontal force to get the cutting power. And then you can divide it by time, and you have energy. Or multiply by time, and then you have energy. So basically, we need the bottom line of the two, which is the horizontal force, and look where is that force at a minimum, because where that force is at a minimum, that's probably what nature will do. It's never a guarantee, but usually nature is lazy and nature doesn't want to spend more energy than required. Yeah, so based on that principle, it's a little bit a philosophical principle, we find the beta. Then you can see for the 60 degree blade, in fact, the point where you have the minimum for both forces, total force and horizontal force, is almost at the same beta, and yeah, it would be, if you look there, around 20 degrees. Then you can go to the 45 degree. You can see the difference between horizontal force and vertical force is a little bit bigger, not much, just a little bit. But you can also see that the point where you find the minimum has increased. Well, what would it be? something like 27, 28 degrees. And then you go to the 30 degree blade, you can see that the difference between the minima is a little bit bigger. Now, yeah, where is this minimum? Just about 30 degrees. So a simple rule of the thumb based on this is that for a 60 degree blade, the shear angle is between 15 and 20 degrees. Then if you go to the 45, it's between 25 and 30 degrees, and usually for a 30 degree blade, it's around 30 degrees. Yeah, so if the blade angle decreases, the shear angle increases. And I also made a drawing of the lines for the 15 degree blade, which is a very unpractical blade, but we did tests with such blades, and you can see that you are above 35 degrees. Yeah, so the tendency of an increasing shear angle with a decreasing blade angle is valid. Why is a 15 degree blade not practical? Well, if you have a blade like this, 15 degrees is very flat, and the blade has a point, it means an edge, it means the edge will become very sharp. And if you would use such a blade in reality, and you just hit one piece of gravel, the blade is broken because you can't make it strong enough. That's why in general in dredging, if you look at a cutter head, I would say the blade angles they use are between 50 and 60 degrees. So they are not too small. It has a number of reasons. So one of the reasons is that a very small blade angle makes it very vulnerable. And in dredging, you can say I'm dredging sand or clay. There will always be some gravel somewhere. You will always hit those stones. Yeah, so it has to be strong enough. But the second reason is that in a cutter head you are rotating. That means at the bottom of your blade you get wear. And if you have a very flat blade, that also means the wear surface at the bottom will also become very big. And yeah, in the case you have a lot of wear, your forces increase dramatically and it won't work. If I have a much steeper blade, then yeah, also the wear flat is much smaller, so the effect of wear is much smaller. The influence of wear. So how do you determine the influence of wear? In fact, this is about the influence of wear on the pore pressures. If theoretically you have a blade with a very sharp edge, that means the water in the back of the blade reaches the edge of the blade. That also means that theoretically the pressure at the point at the edge of the blade is zero. Yeah, is hydrostatic, but hydrostatic we call it zero in this respect. You cannot have under pressure at a point where you also have hydrostatic pressure. So that reduces the pressures from the calculations dramatically. We know that in reality you always have some wear, but also that during the cutting process the sand is compacted a little bit. Behind the blade it will move up a little bit, and the result is that the water behind the blade can never reach the edge of the blade. And to test that, we made blades with a wear flat, so a horizontal piece behind the edge of the blade, and determined the pore pressures. Well, this is the pressure in the shear plane, the average pressure. This is the average pressure on the blade, and the W is the length of the wear flat, and HI was the thickness of the layer cut. And what do you see? That if you increase the size of the wear flat, you get, let's say, asymptotically to a certain stable situation. And that's what we choose for the size of this weir flat, because you like it if it's reproducible. And you could say, yeah, maybe this under pressure is a little bit too high. Well, the minimum is here, so it's not really too high. But it's better if you overestimate the forces a little bit than when you underestimate, because if they design a project based on forces that are too low, you may damage your equipment. Yeah, so based on that philosophy, we said it's better to be a little bit too high than too low. Then you get the situation of permeability for those calculations. We have the sand before it passes the shear plane, which is still the situ sand with a low permeability. Then, when the sand is shearing, the particles roll over each other, the porosity is increasing, so also the permeability is increasing. Yeah, but how to deal with that in such a finite element program? Well, the program we had at that time, it's still at the university, could deal with that. You can make two areas with different permeabilities, and we looked at the influence of the ratio between those permeabilities on the cutting force. Well, the ratio here, you can see the Ki is the permeability of the sand in situ, so before shearing, and the Kmax is the permeability after shearing. And you can see that if this ratio is increasing, the force is decreasing. Why is that? Well, the Ki is fixed, because that's the permeability you have from the sand. If the permeability Kmax is decreasing, is getting smaller, this axis goes to the right. But if that if that permeability is getting smaller, the force is also getting smaller. But if you take the reversed of this curve here, you see it's a nice straight line. And based on that straight line, we found that almost exactly, you can just take the Ki plus the Kmax and divide it by 2 and use that permeability in your equations. And just take the average of the two permeabilities. Last week, I think we stopped with those equations. We already looked at this. So you had the C1, which was the result of the finite element calculation, plus all the sines and cosines that are in the equation, including the beta, where the cutting forces are at a minimum. Rho times G, I told you, normally I use 10 for that combination, but if you put it in a computer program, just do it as accurate as possible. Vc was the cutting velocity, so in meters per second. Hi, the thickness of the layer you are cutting, and it was squared because on one hand the pore pressures will be proportional to the layer, the thickness of the layer cut. If it's 2 times as thick, the pore pressures will be doubled. But since force is the integral of the pore pressures, you get a second time this layer thickness, and that's why it's squared. B was the width of the blade, E was the dilatation, so the increase of the volume of the sand, with a value, normally I choose something like 0.1, 0.2 in that range, but if you know the exact numbers of the porosities, you can calculate it. Yeah, but if I don't, I have to make an estimate. And Km is that average permeability, so it's just the average of the permeability before shearing and after shearing. For the FV, you get the same reasoning. The only difference is you have a C2. Now, if you don't know anything about the sand, you should make a what I call an educated guess, and that would be that C1 is 0.5 and C2 is 0. Yeah, that means you don't have a vertical force. Then, in the cavitating equations, so once the water starts cooking in the pores, you have a D1. The educated gas for D1 is 5. Yeah, so 10 times C1, but it's 5. But because the equation is completely different, you cannot compare C1 and D1. Again, the density of water times the G, which we estimate 10. Between brackets, Z plus 10, Z is the water depth. And the 10 is because of atmospheric pressure, yeah, because rho times G times 10 is exactly 100 kPa, which is 1 bar. Yeah, so the 10 is just the atmospheric pressure. And then for each 10 meters of water depth, you can add a 10. Again, the HI, the layer thickness. Why is it not squared here? Well, the pressure is a constant. Once you are cavitating, the pressure is a constant, and the pressure doesn't depend on the layer thickness anymore. So the only reason I have an H is because I have to integrate that pressure over the layer thickness, and that's when I get 1H in this equation. And then you see the B, the width of the blade, which makes sense. If the blade has a width which is 2 times, probably the force will be 2 times. It's not 100% because you have some side effects, but in the 2D situation. If you make those two equations equal, you get an equation like this. And if this equation is 1, you are at the transition between the non-cavitating and the cavitating process. Yeah, if it's 1, it's just making the two equations equal. Well, we talked about cavitation. Cavitation, if it occurs, it will start in the shear plane. And in that shear plane, yeah, this is the area where you saw on previous pictures that we had the biggest underpressures. Well, where you have the biggest underpressures, cavitation will start. But cavitation means the increase of porosity has been filled with vapor bubbles, not with water. So during the process, it will not just disappear. You need water to fill up that volume. So the sand is moving like this over the blade. From this side, water is flowing to that cavitation area, filling up the pores with water. And it takes a while, actually, before the cavitation has disappeared. The cavitation can also occur here before the shear plane, just because that area is catching water from the surroundings. So it could already start a little bit sooner. If you measure here, I show you the points where we had pressure transducers in the blade. So we had, we call it differential pressure transducers. We can measure the pore pressure in the sand, not the pressure of the sand, of the particles, just the pore pressure. And yeah, as long as you have this cavitation spot in front of your blade, you will measure a high underpressure, and then where the cavitation spot has disappeared, the underpressure will drop. So you get something like this. Anyway, that's what we would expect. This shows again where did we put the pressure transducers, because we already expected that near the edge of the blade there will be high gradients of the pressure, while if you go to the back of the blade, yeah, the change of the pressure is much less. So we liked to put the transducers as close as we could to the edge, but you can see in this area, because there you have the edge of the blade, you cannot really put those transducers, just no space. Why does it look the way it looks? Well, in fact, the actual pressure transducer was put behind the blade. When the sand is moving on the blade, you get a lot of wear. So in fact, what I'm telling you is a little bit how to do such an experiment. So if I would put this pressure transducer in the blade, after one test, no more transducer, because the sand would wear it off and it would be so damaged you can't use it again. Okay, so what to do? So we decided we make holes, but if you just make a hole in the blade, yeah, the hole will be filled up with sand, and then what? You like to keep it clean. So we decided we make small pills like aspirins to put in front. But those pills have to be, on one hand, they have to be very hard because they have to resist the wear of the sand. On the other hand, they have to be completely permeable because you want to measure all the changes in the pressure in the water. And if those pills are not permeable, yeah, then the pressure transducer will not measure anything. Now the problem is, if you make those pills, so we found the right material to make those pills, you make aspirins in fact, they are full of air. And if you just put them in, and then put water on top, yeah, the air is still in those small pills, because why would it go out? That means air is very compressible, so air in such a small pill would behave like what we call a low-pass filter and filter out all the high-frequency changes in the pressure. You wouldn't measure a thing, only over longer periods, if there are pressure differences, you could measure something. So what we did, we made a lot of those pills. We borrowed a vacuum tank in one of the other departments, put them in a glass of water, and put absolute vacuum in that vacuum tank. So almost zero bar absolute pressure in the vacuum tank. And then you can see all the air go out, because it's vacuum, and we left it there for a week. And then after a week you could assume all the air was out of those pills, but you have to keep them underwater. You cannot take them out and put them in the test facility because there will be air in again. Yes, so we had to take the glass of water with those pills, step with a wetsuit, step in the laboratory in the tank with water, you will see some pictures of that, and put the glass underwater, taking care those pills would never be in contact with air. Otherwise it won't work. Well, that was a lot of work, but it worked. Now, first, if you look at the under pressures based on those finite element calculations, here you see the blade with the locations of the transducers, and AB is the shear plane. So A was the edge of the blade and B was where the shear plane reaches the surface. Well, it's logic that at the point where the shear plane reaches the surface, the pressure is zero. Then it's increasing, and near the edge of the blade you could have a maximum, although it doesn't have to be a full maximum, as you can see here. And in fact, at the blade we used that wear surface to take wear and other effects into account. Then on the blade you can see that in fact just behind the edge of the blade you find the maximum, but it completely depends on the blade angle and the layer thickness and so on. And then over the blade you see it drop to zero, because at the end of the blade it's in contact with water, with hydrostatic pressure, so the pressure is here. So this is what we calculated, and then you like to know, does it really happen? But before I show you some data from the laboratory, the method which is not scientifically correct, but which works very well, and in fact some students did whole master degree assignments with this method to solve certain problems, and they actually solved it well. This method we call the parallel resistor method. I don't think in soil mechanics you will ever get it, but it works very well. You can say if I have a point on the shear plane, then the water could flow from four directions, theoretically. Here this is direction one, direction two, direction three, direction four. Of each direction, I can determine the length. For example, I can say this is a circle segment, and so if I know the location on the shear plane, I can calculate the length of that circle segment. Here you have a circle segment plus a straight line. Here you also have two circle segments plus here a piece of straight line. So it's a little bit engineering intuition how to implement the method, but this is the way I did it. Now, the resistance of one line, so the water flow over one line, is the length of that line divided by the permeability. So if you take the length of a flow line divided by the permeability, it gives you a resistance. From electronics, or electrical engineering, we know that if you have parallel resistors, there is a rule how to determine the total resistance of a number of parallel resistors. In fact, the 1 divided by the total resistance equals 1 divided by the first resistance plus 1 divided by the second resistance, etc., etc. So this is the way how to determine the total resistance. And in fact, for each line, you know the S divided by K, because you know in which area you are before shearing or after shearing. Yeah? So you know the K value, and you have to make an estimate for the length. I use circle segments, but if you say I want to make it more fancy, no problem. The difference is not very much. If you choose a little bit different approach, the values will almost be the same. Then, if I know this resistance, the under pressure at that point on the shear plane, you can calculate with this equation. So in fact, the density of water, G, cutting velocity, E, and the sine of beta. So basically, this is a constant. And then what I do, I divide the shear plane in, let's say, 100 steps, 100 small parts, and on each part I determine this under pressure. That way I get a nice curve of the under pressure over the whole shear plane. I can integrate it, and that gives me the average under pressure on the shear plane. Another advantage of it is that for each point I can check whether I exceed the water vapor pressure. And if I do, I can limit the outcome to the water vapor pressure. So the transition between no cavitation and cavitation can be determined very smoothly using this method. I just want to show you the method. Why did some students use it? Well, we had students who wanted to investigate if you have the drag head of a hopper dredge and you have those teeth. IHC, not so long ago, a couple of years ago, they put water jets inside the teeth in order to compensate for the under pressure in the sand. They said if we can blow water into the sand before it starts dilatating, we don't have those under pressures, and they call it actually the dragon head. And the student wanted to calculate how does it work. Well, with this method, you are more flexible in determining underpressures, because everywhere you have the overpressure of the water jet, you don't have underpressure. So you can define that, and they actually graduated, and what they calculated matched reality. In fact, I tuned this method on the finite element program, the finite element method, and the difference is just a few percent. So, and this I can put in any computer program, and I do not have to wait until the finite element program has finished. Yeah, it's like 20 lines of code in a computer program, and you can use it for everything. And then if the accuracy is a few percent, okay, that's good enough. This picture you already saw when I discussed soil mechanics, I think. What is it? Well, in order to predict cutting forces, very often what you have is SPT values and things like that. Although here in Holland we have good laboratories. Here you have somewhere here you have the old soil mechanics laboratory, and you have the Deltares and so on, and they can do sophisticated tests. But that's not everywhere in the world. So one reason is it's not always available. So for example, you have a project on Borneo. Do you think somewhere in Borneo they have a very sophisticated soil mechanics laboratory? Probably not. Still, you have to do a project there, and you like to know something about the soil. So you can do SPT, you can do CPT, but usually it's tests that you can do locally. If you want to know more about the material, you have to send it by plane to a good laboratory and wait for the results. Well, what does this picture show you? Here you have SPT value. Here you have relative density. Relative density was, if it's zero, it means you have the highest porosity of your sand. If it's 100%, you have the lowest porosity of your sand. So you can see if the porosity is of the sand is decreasing, the relative density is increasing, and then the SPT value is also increasing. Yeah, it just gives you a feeling. How does it change from very loose to very dense material? Then, if we know the SPT value, you also have the angle of internal friction as a function of the SPT value. This gives you that function, so you can also see here loose up to very dense, so in fact that's the relative density again. And so if I would have 40 SPT, which we consider a hard sand, okay, 40, that would mean I'm here, I would have an angle of internal friction of 38, 39 degrees. This method is not very accurate. In fact, the red lines give the upper and lower limit, which is plus and minus 3 degrees. But if you don't know anything, you have a method to determine some values of the sand. Well, if I estimate my angle of internal friction and I take 2/3 of that value, I have my angle of external friction. Yeah, so I can make some estimates. Well, last thing before the break, then we get to specific energy. What is specific energy? Specific energy, and it counts for all types of soil, not just for sand. We use it in all types of soil. If you divide the cutting power by the production, Q is the volume flow of material. So that's the production, cubic meters per second. If I divide those two, I get energy per cubic meter. Well, the power is force times velocity. Yeah, that's general for power. The production is the layer thickness times the width of the blade times the cutting velocity. And then you can see the cutting velocity is in both, so apparently I can divide the VC out of the equation. If I do that for the cavitating cutting process, and I do that because in dredging with cutter heads, normally the velocities are so high that it's always cavitating. Yeah, so that's what we are interested in. You get this simple equation for the specific energy. I already told you the D, if you don't know anything, take a value of 5. Okay, so if I take a 5, rho times G is 10. And suppose the water depth is also 10, you get 5 times 10 times 20 is 1000 kPa, which means my specific energy for such a sand would be 1000 kPa. Here you see the equation again. Now you can also reverse this and say, okay, so if I know the installed power of my cutter head, I just reverse the equation and I can determine the production. So the production is the installed power divided by the specific energy. So suppose I have a cutter head with 1 megawatt installed power. 1 megawatt is 1000 kilowatt. If I divide 1000 kilowatt by 1000 kPa, I get 1. That would mean such a cutter head has a production of 1 cubic meter per second. This is based on just energy considerations, so I'm not looking at the cutter dredge and check if the cutter dredge is capable of having such a swing speed that it can do 1 cubic meter per second. I didn't look at that. All I look at is the power of the cutter head enough to cut 1 cubic meter per second? Well, in this case, in this specific example, it is. Yeah, because specific energy is 1000, installed power is 1000. If you divide it, you get 1 cubic meter per second. Well, this is the way to determine your production. There are other limitations which I will discuss later. But at the exam you could get questions: if I have such and such a sand, determine the specific energy, I have a cutter head with so much installed power, what would be the production? But I can also reverse it and say, if this is the production, what should be the installed power or whatever. You can do it in many directions. Based on the previous slides, where I had a relation between the SPT value and the angle of internal friction, I derived those equations, those three equations for 30, 45 and 60 degree blades, where if you know the phi, the angle of internal friction, you can determine the D1, and if you do that for something like 35, 40 degrees for the 60 degree blade, you should get close to the 5. Yeah, but in fact the D1 could range from, let's say, 2 to 10, and that's roughly the range. Okay, we have a break. Well, we saw the specific energy, so here you see the equations again. And here I made a graph with horizontally the SPT value, vertically the specific energy of the sand, and a set of water depth. So we start at 0 meter water depth and we end at 30 with steps of 5 meter, and you can see where you are. Well, normally hard sand would be in the range of 40 to 50 SPT, and if you look at that, 40 to 50 SPT, you move up. Well, the first line would be 0 meter water depth, and you would arrive at something like 600 kPa specific energy. But in the example I gave before the break, we said if we have 10 meters, we would arrive at about 1,000. Well, look at the 10 meters, which is the straight line here, 40 to 50 straight line. We are close to the 1,000 kPa. Yeah, so that works. But if the water depth is bigger, for every 10 meters of water depth, you can multiply the specific energy with a factor. So 0 is 1, 10 meters is 2, 20 meters is 3, etc., etc. So every time you have to add up the number 1. So if 0 meters water depth would be 500 kPa, then 10 meters is 1,000, 20 meters is 1,500, 30 meters is 2,000. And that means if I go from 10 meters to 30 meters, the specific energy doubles, and that means the production goes to 50%. So with the same cutter dredge, the amount of sand I can dredge, but this is the maximum. It doesn't always mean I'm dredging the maximum, but if I would dredge the maximum, then at 30 meters the maximum is 50% of the 10 meters. This chart gives you the productions per 100 kilowatt installed power on the cutter head, and you can see how it is decreasing with increasing SPT value. But here both axes are logarithmic. By the way, yesterday I already put all those slides on Blackboard, so you can check it. And I'm almost ready with the lecture notes, so I will also put them, but I still have to write some text. The lecture note you will get is not yet 100% finished, because it's too much. If I would finish it in 1 year, I would work full-time on just writing lecture notes, but there is enough for all the lectures to understand and to see all the equations that you need. Experiments. Well, we used to have a laboratory, and I just saw Mr. Ni from China. His father is the dredging professor in Changzhou in China, and he just told me they are building a new laboratory, some of the biggest dredging laboratory in the world, somewhere in China. But at the location of his father in Changzhou, close to Shanghai, they also have a laboratory like this. We used to have one, but because of Delft University policy, another group needed that space, so we lost that laboratory. We still have a laboratory, but not as big anymore. Well, we used to have a laboratory with a big concrete tank. That tank was 2.5 meters in width, about 36 meters long, and on top of the tank there was a carriage, a vehicle that could drive over the tank, and under that vehicle you could mount blades or cutter heads or whatever you want. It was driven by a winch, an infinite winch, and we had a cabin with all the measurement equipment to get all the data from all the measurements. This is a cross-section of that tank. So here you see the concrete tank. Here you see a side tank. Why did we have a side tank? Because if you do cutting tests, you get a lot of turbidity of the sand moving up, and that would mean with an underwater camera you cannot see anything because of all the turbidity. So when we do tests with a cutter head, the sand goes into the suction mouth, which is this pipe, is transported through a pump, dumped in the side tank, and that way we could keep the water clean. At the bottom, this is the sand, at the bottom we had a drainage system, so we could pump in or out water. Why did we do that? Well, if you pump water in, and in fact we needed the fire department connections to have enough flow, we could make all the sand fluid, and then if you do that, so you pump water up, all the garbage that is in the water will float to the top, like clay particles, but also real garbage. And you could scrape it away one time and that way keep the sand clean, because if you get too many clay particles and fines in the sand, it influences the permeability and you don't want that. You want to have a very controllable permeability. So that's when we pump water in. When we pump water out, we create a huge underpressure at the bottom of the tank, and that way you can compact the sand much better. Yeah? Later I will show you how we really compact the sand. Well, this was the carriage, so you see the big tank and the side tank. Here we have a so-called dust pan, so after a test we can suck out the sand and pump it back to the main tank. This is a cutter head that we used, 40 centimeters in diameter. This one was for cutting rock. And here you see, this is that same cutter head. This is a cutter head with smooth blades. And we use this one for cutting clay. I already told you, if you have clay with a high adhesion, it will stick between anything it can stick. So if I would cut clay with this cutter head, within 5 minutes it's completely filled with clay and blocked and I can't dredge anymore. But if I would use this one, it's okay. Here you see the carriage with a blade at the bottom. In fact, I just did this in Corel Draw because the real blade had too much rust on it, so I just painted it. This is the real blade, and you see the sand here. This is how we mounted the blade under the carriage. So what you can see is a center blade and two side blades. And each blade is mounted in force transducers and moment transducers, or torque transducers. And why is it? Well, the theory is two-dimensional. So if you want to check your theory, you need to have 2D tests. So on the center blade, we measured the 2D process, and on the side blades, you also have the side effects, which are 3D. Yeah? So we could distinguish between the center blade and the side blade. For later research, we put a window here with a camera behind it, so we could actually see if the sand is moving over the blade. Now, when you do a cutting test, the distance between those blades has to be very small, because you don't want sand to go in between, but on the other hand, they shouldn't touch each other, because you get a force influence if they actually touch each other. So, but what happened at some tests, when building the laboratory, some people were welding in the neighborhood of the tank, and after finishing the welding, they just throw those small pieces of welding material into the sand. And when we did tests, so that's like, I would say, 3 millimeter, 4 millimeter thick bars from the welding device. Actually, they went through this gap. The gap was only 0.1 millimeter, but the forces were so high that the pressure pressed them in between. And behind the blade, we had those pressure transducers with pipes and so on. And those welding things, they went straight through it and everything was broken. So the forces and the stresses can become so high that something you don't expect will still happen. This is the whole mounting system. I just show it for your information. So the center blade and the two side blades. Here you see what we call dynamometers to measure forces and torques. So we could actually measure everything. Those are the blades. So you can see how they were constructed. This is the actual blade, but this is the holder. And it has this shape because you don't want the holder to influence the cutting process. It shouldn't touch the sand. Here you can see a blade with a wear flat. So we weld it a triangle of steel at the tip of the blade to simulate wear of the blade, and we also did tests with that. This is 45 degrees, 60 degrees, 30 degrees, and we also had a 15 degree blade, but then you can already imagine it's too flat, it becomes too flat. The tank had windows, and we actually mounted cameras on the outside connected to the vehicle, so if the whole thing is moving, the camera is also moving, and then in front of the blade you can record what is going on, but only if the water is clean. But we also used underwater cameras. In fact, we mounted a camera in the back of the blade, so because the first thing you do when you do research, you want to observe the physics. Don't just start with equations or whatever. First, observe the physics, do some orientation tests, see what is actually going on, so you get a feeling this is what is happening, and describe it in words, not in equations. Yeah? Describe it in words. Because if you are not capable of describing in words what is going on, you can never explain to other people what you are doing. So the first step is just in words. Explain the physics in words. Here you see that window again. And this is when we prepare the sand, because you can say, oh, there's sand in the tank, we just do a test. But you want the tests to be reproducible. Every time the sand should be the same. So this is an egalizer here to make the sand flat, have a flat bed. And here you see two concrete vibration needles, and we use those to compact the sand, because you don't want loose sand. Loose sand doesn't give a problem. We like very dense sand. How to make the sand dense? Well, the vehicle will move with very low speed over the sand. Those vibration needles vibrate the sand. That way they compact it. And at the same time, we found that if we put the drainage system on and suck out the water, creating under pressure in the sand, we get a better reproducibility of the sand. Yeah? So then each time the sand is almost the same. 100% is not possible, but almost. What did we get out of such a test? This is just a sheet as an example, the raw data. We have six signals, horizontal force, vertical force, and then four pore pressure transducers, where P1 is at the end of the blade and P4 is at the tip of the blade, and you can see that both the forces and the pressures are not nice constant signals in time, but they go up and down. I already told you that the failing process of sand is the shear type, where you have a buildup of pressure. When the pressure is high enough, a shear plane shoots to the surface that releases the pressure on the blade. It moves forward, builds up the pressure again, you get a shear plane again, etc. So this up and down, what you can see here, every peak is a shear plane shooting to the surface. And based on that, if you count the number of peaks in such a signal, you know the number of shear planes that you had, and you divide it by the time, and you can find the distance, the thickness of each shear plane. So that's the reason why it's not a nice constant force, but it goes up and down. What is that? Oh. Yeah, now it works. Okay, this is a picture of measurements of those pore pressure transducers. In fact, over a whole test, we determined the average of all those signals, and the average we put in graphs. Well, what you see here, this is the blade, and you see the location of the pressure transducers. this is two series with a Weir flat and without a Weir flat. The blue line is the result of the finite element programming, so the numerical solution. You can see the red with the Weir is a little bit above the theory. The green is a little bit below the theory, but in general it matches pretty well. And if I would change the size of the Weir flat in the finite element calculations, I could reduce or increase this peak that you have near the edge. That one was for a very long blade. You can imagine, well, if I show it again, if you have a very long blade, most of the underpressures will occur near the tip of the blade, but then it reduces rapidly. But if I have a very small blade, and small is in relation with the layer thickness, then I get a shape like this. And again, you see the measurements with Weir and without Weir. So with Weir is always a little bit higher because, yeah, the water cannot flow there, so the underpressures will be a bit higher. But the difference is not so much that I really need two separate finite element calculations for it. Here, I have measurements. The previous two graphs were dimensionless, so I divided by many things to make it dimensionless. Here, you have measurements in absolute pressures, but in meters water column, not in Pascal, but meters water column. Well, the maximum you have is 10 meters water column, because the amount of water above the scent is so little we can neglect it. That means if I get an underpressure of 10 meters water column, I have full cavitation. Well, what we got, you can see what happens. This is the cutting velocity, and you can see the lowest one, the blue line here. Well, I'm far from having cavitation, but if I go to the highest speeds up here, then near the edge of the blade, I have 9 meters under pressure or something which is already close to cavitation. One thing you have to keep in mind by when you do such experiments, and that's again air. If you would just have like less than 1% air in the water, and air is compressible, so also expandable, then I made calculations for that with just a little bit air in the water, I would never reach the 10 meter water column under pressure. I would be stuck at about 9 meter, just because of less than 1% air in the water. And if you see how the water is pumped into such a tank with a lot of turbidity, you can imagine there will always be some air dissolved in the water. And in fact, if you have very tiny air bubbles in the sand, it's almost impossible to get it out, because you cannot put the whole tank in a vacuum tank, it's too big. And so once you have some air in the sand, it will be there, and then with thermodynamics you can calculate how the air will expand if you get those under pressure. So that's the reason why here we don't actually reach the 10 meters, it's just because there was some air in the water. This is the same, but for a sand with a lower permeability, because the lower the permeability, the higher the underpressures, and here you can see for small velocities, we don't have cavitation, but for the highest velocities you can see that shape that I showed you theoretically. So everywhere you have that cavitation area close to the blade, you will have an underpressure which is close to the cavitation underpressure. Then some forces, horizontal forces. This is from three sets of measurements, and the blue line is the theoretical line, and you can see that, yeah, the measured points are a little bit higher than the theory, but not that much. If in reality you can make an estimate within 10%, every company will be happy. So the difference that you see here is not much. And in fact, you could say, why not adapt the theory so it matches exactly? You could do that, but then you do another set of tests, and then it's below, and then you have to adapt it again. So the theory, with the constants that I have in the theory, are already based on many, many experiments. And in fact, I always feel theory doesn't have to match 100% with experiments, as long as you get close enough. This is the vertical force. If you look at the horizontal force, you can see a scale to 5. If you look at the vertical force, you see a scale up to 1.5, and that's because the vertical forces are always much smaller than the horizontal forces. A positive force means it pulls the blade into the soil. A negative force means it's pushing it out, and in this case everything is positive. Here you can see some tests in a sand at different layer thicknesses with speeds up to almost 1.5 meter per second. And red is 25 millimeters, green 50 millimeters, and blue is 100 millimeters. And especially with the blue line, well, here you can see it better. You can see it follows the curve. This part is no cavitation, and the horizontal part here is with cavitation. So the fact that in the beginning it's increasing almost proportional to the velocity, but above a certain point it's almost independent of the velocity, you can see here. Yeah, so it matches pretty well. Well, this is the horizontal force, this is the specific energy, and you can see that the specific energy in this case is bigger for a thinner layer. Snowplow effect. We already talked about the snowplow effect, about the fact that in general blades are not perpendicular to the cutting velocity, but they are under an angle. If you have a 3D curved cutter head and you divide the cutter head in small parts, well, such a segment will never be perpendicular to the absolute velocity. So it has a certain deviation angle with the velocity. Well, here we have tests with 0 degrees deviation, so the blade is perpendicular to the velocity, horizontal force, vertical force, and specific energy. And this would be the side force because of the snowplow effect, but it's 0 if it's perpendicular. But in this case, you have a 45 degree blade, so it deviated 45 degrees. So it's a snowplow under 45 degrees. And suddenly you can see that you also get a large side force. And the curves is what we calculated, and the points is what we measured. So we actually did this kind of research. And you see that it gets close enough. Horizontal force and side force get close enough. For the vertical force, you could say there is some deviation, but then on the other hand, the vertical forces in general are so small compared to the other one. Here you have 10, here you, well, most of the forces are like 1.5, and in the negative direction almost nothing. That means if I have a force where the vertical force is almost 0, then the vector is horizontal. If something happens and this vector is moving a little bit downwards or upwards, it has a very large influence on the vertical component, but hardly anything on the horizontal component. And that's what's happening here. So the two horizontal forces, and this one is straightforward and this one is to the side, they have quite a magnitude. The vertical force is always small compared to those two. We also like to determine the friction based on tests. You can do it in a laboratory, but you can also, from your cutting test, you can also try to derive it. In fact, what do you measure? A horizontal force and a vertical force. Then, if you use pore pressure measurements or finite element calculations, you can determine a normal force, friction force, and the two pore pressure forces. Oh. It looks like the battery is empty. So factorial, you can make such a graph and that way determine what would be the delta value that we actually had during the test. So we also did that, and that's how we found that using 2/3 of the internal friction angle is a good way. Yeah. Heb jij nog een... Nee. Verkeerde batterij. Ja, vindt u, gebruiken we die gewoon. Okay, so that was the normal cutting process. And in some cases, I already explained in the beginning, in the cutting equations, you divide by the sine of the sum of four angles. And if the sum of those four angles gets close to 180 degrees, it means you will divide by almost zero, and then the cutting forces would become infinite. Well, nature will not do that, so nature will find another way to deal with that problem. So nature will create a wedge. And this wedge can be static and it can be dynamic. If we call it static, it means the sand inside the wedge is not moving anymore, it doesn't have velocity. If it's dynamic, it means it's still moving, but maybe not with a constant speed or anything, maybe you have a velocity gradient somewhere, but it could still move. So if we say, okay, this is what's going to happen if the sum of those four angles gets too close to 180 degrees, then how to determine the shape of that wedge? Because you can see the wedge has an angle theta, we call it a wedge angle. If I know this wedge angle, I could calculate everything because I can put it in a finite element program to determine my under pressures, I can solve the equilibrium of forces, moments, all those things. But I have to know this theta. Well, first of all, and you already saw those pictures, but not for sand. First of all, we have to look at all the forces that we have. And in this picture, I only put the forces that we have in sand. In the picture you saw last week, I think, I really put all the forces, so also adhesion, cohesion, and so on. Here you only see the forces that you have in saturated sand. So what do we have? On the shear plane, normal force and shear force, and the pore pressure force. And on the blade, also normal force, shear force, and pore pressure force. All the other forces we are going to neglect. They are either not there, or they are so small that they do not influence the process. Then, on the wedge, it looks more complicated, but in fact it's not really. You have the same set of forces on each plane, and normal force, shear force, and pore pressure force. And the thing is, how to get them, how to determine them. But, in this case, having two equations for vertical and horizontal equilibrium is not enough. We also need the equilibrium of moments. And this is the forces on the blade. You already saw such pictures before. And here you have the forces that determine the moments. So you have the normal forces and the pore pressure forces. You have to know both in order to determine the equilibrium of moments. We take the equilibrium of moments around the edge, the tip of the blade, but you could do it in any point. If there is an equilibrium of moments, it should exist around each point. The thing is, if I use the tip of the edge, many forces go through the tip of the edge, so I do not have to take them into account for the equilibrium of moments. Like the shear force on this plane goes through the tip of the blade, so it doesn't result in a moment, and then the equations become more simple. So the choice of where, around which point do you take the moments, just depends on what makes the equations as simple as possible. Well, we have the same problem with the pore pressure. The water flows to the shear plane, but actually, so this plane is shearing. You have dilatation here. Here you do not have dilatation, since the sand can only have dilatation once. And if it's a static wedge in front of the blade, that sand can only have dilatation once. Once it's expanded, it will not expand more. So in the wedge and on this plane, I do not have dilatation. Yeah, only in the shear plane. Same picture as before for determining where does the flow come from with the boundary conditions of the finite element program. Again, a coarse mesh, although this one already looks pretty fine. And here you have a fine mesh. And this is the result. And what you see from those calculations, you get the highest under pressures in the shear plane. But in the wedge, not much is happening. What I found is for the pore pressure calculations, you can almost say, I just assume the wedge is also made of steel, and then the results of pore pressure calculations do not really differ much from what we did with the finite element program. So in our calculations, the water could flow through the wedge, although we didn't have dilatation there, but the water could flow through. But it didn't really influence the pore pressures in the shear plane a lot. Yeah, so you could almost use the same values. Well, here you see the flow lines. And you can see the yellow, which is high flow, but in the wedge, you can see there is not much flow based on the colors. And this graph shows how the pore pressures develop along the different lines. So from A to B, of B to A, B is where the shear plane reaches the surface. So there your pressures are zero because you have hydrostatic pressure. Then you see the curve going to A. A is the tip of the wedge, not of the blade, but of the wedge. Then from A to D, you have the bottom of the wedge. So you go from the tip of the edge to the bottom, to the tip of the blade. You can see how that develops. Then D, C is the blade itself. And C, A is the top of the blade to the tip of the wedge, in that direction. And you can see how it develops. The top one is for a case where you have a blade and such a wedge with a shape like this, so a 90 degree blade with quite a wedge. This one is the case where you have like such a blade and then a small wedge in front of it, and that's why the bottom of the wedge is very small. And this distance is the bottom of the wedge. And then you can see what that looks like. And in fact, such a calculation should almost give exactly the same result as the case where you don't have any wedge. Yeah, so that's a way to check if the calculations are correct. One more slide, I think. No, we will stop here and then tomorrow continue with a good laser pointer.